Well, thank you very much. It's unfortunately one of the bad sides of having these virtual conversations is that we don't hear the 100 or 200 people clapping at the end, which kind of kills the moment. But it was
it's sort of like a Zen process. What does one hand clapping sound like?
Yeah, but thank you. It was a very, very interesting talk, very in line with what we know about your work. And it was a great pleasure to hear you speak out loud about that.
Thank you.
Since we do have a few questions here, but I think the best part of inviting me to moderate this, of accepting the invitation to moderate this question, is that I get to ask the first question, if you don't mind. And one of the things I found very curious about the way you present things is that you put a lot of emphasis on what I would describe as care, or that marvelous English phrase that we don't have a good translation in Portuguese, which is to give a damn, because we, even in the first slides you presented, the scientist works consciously on the problem, but then works unconsciously on the problem because he or she cares about the problem. We develop creative solutions because we care about the problems.
Well, that may I interrupt for a moment? I didn't say scientists. Everyone working on research, artists, musicians, and writers too.
Sure. But since you were talking about Poincaré, that's why I gave the scientist idea. Yeah. But definitely, I think you made a marvelous description about that problem, and I certainly don't want to ruin it. But what one of the things that you also mentioned is that for now, part of the problem could actually, I don't know if you agree with me, but could actually be related to that. For now, machines as we know it don't give a damn about nothing. They don't really care about nothing, even though the examples you gave, very interesting examples about the competitiveness and all of that being already signs of a possible emergence of that. But the question I was having was along these lines, was what do you think, what if, because we tend to think nowadays that that logic and information come at a more fundamental level, and then care is something, or giving a damn is something that emerges from that. But what if, as some authors seem to imply or even actively defend, what if giving a damn, what if care is actually on a more fundamental level, and actually our intelligence, our ability to even gather information or even have the concept of information, if that emerges from the care and care is at a more fundamental level, do you think that can make any difference, or do you think that's just nonsense? What do you think about that?
Well, there will be emphatic machines, but not right now. They don't exist right now, but they will exist in the future. Right now, machines have gone beyond merely problem solving, as I hope I've shown. The way things, one has to start somewhere, okay? So one starts with machines, wires, transistors, and then moves along from there. And out of these machines emerge such things as unpredictability, okay? And going beyond an algorithm. And that's already moving towards emotions. And as I said, machines will learn this from reading the web. Mm-hmm. And they'll learn about falling in love. And they'll learn about, machines will be speaking to each other at a fairly advanced state some years in the future. And one machine might say to itself, I had a very nice discussion with the machine down the street. I think I'm in love when I read about love from the web. And it will be able to convince us that it is in love. I mean, we are basically machines. I think we should bear that in mind. We're biological machines at one level, chemical machines at a deeper level, masses of elementary particles working together at some lower level, at some basic level. And what has emerged from all of this is our emphatic dimension. And that will occur with machines as well.
I think anyone who's seen Wall-E, the movie, will recognize that robot is in love, right? So right. if we're able to approach something like that, I think that will be related to this.
Even the replicants in Blade Runner mm-hmm. are even a better example.
Okay,
where their physiology, like a wet physiology.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Related to this, we have a question by Henrique Lopes Cardoso. Does machine creativity imply the capability of critically appreciating the created artifacts? I think this is a very important question.
Well, it already does on a basic level, in that generative adversarial networks assess the images that are generated, assess the work that is generated. And yes, eventually machines will be able to critique their own work. There is another example of this in the work of Simon Colton, in which he has a drawing bot, and this bot somebody will sit in front of it for their portrait, and some of its memory is taken up by what it has read that day in the Guardian. Mm-hmm. And if it has read too many depressing stories, it will say, "I can't paint your picture today. I'm too depressed." but it will eventually paint the picture, and then go through machinations, and then assess the work. It will compare the portrait that it has painted using face recognition software with the original mm-hmm. person, and if it's not good, if it's too unhappy, and so on, it will start over again. So machines are beginning to assess their work on a primitive level, but nevertheless, it's being done. It's a step.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. We have another question by Makarand Velankar. I'm sorry if I'm not pronouncing your name correctly. Can we measure or quantify creativity?
What do you mean by that?
Well, I don't mean anything because it's not my question.
Okay, well, I noted indicators of creativity. Mm-hmm. Whether something is surprising, novel, complex, and ambiguous.
Mm-hmm.
So in that sense, you can quantify it. I mean, you can quantify it as the importance of the object or idea.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, surely you and I finding a new route to drive to work is one example of creativity, and finding a new theory of relativity is at quite another level.
Mm-hmm.
And machines will be able to quantify their own creativity also. As I've said, there's a step in that direction, using mm-hmm. generative adversarial networks.
But what if, now it's my question as a follow-up of what you said, what if the actual mechanisms of quantifying creativity are different from us and the machines? So for example, for me, it's actually quite an astonishing step to discover the theory of relativity, but it's quite easy to find a new way to work. But what if, for the machine, it's actually the opposite? Could it be possible that some problems, I think it's actually very feasible, but shouldn't we also speak about this measuring creativity from the perspective of a machine, which is different from the perspective of the human? Do you think that makes sense?
Well, I would say, I mean, talking about what doesn't exist with machines right now, namely an emphatic emotion dimension, that a machine would be very pleased with itself with move number 37 in AlphaGo. And consider rather trivial finding a new way to work when we have driving machines.
And yeah, and for this moment now, it would be a huge step for machines to actually being able to fall in love, something that every human does without much effort.
Absolutely. Right now, a machine can't do it. I mean, one has to be kind to these things, and you know, start off walking slowly, and then moving quickly. I mean, machines will be. Will undergo embodiment. That is to say, they'll be put in the heads of robots. And in that way, machines will develop a sense of touch and even that thing called common sense. It might be able to even tie its own shoelaces.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Another question by Emilcar Cardoso, who shared the first session of these Creativity Talks. Do you think that at some stage, machines can start making and programming and training other machines at their own images? Will in that case humans lose control over the process?
Well, machines are already programming themselves to some extent. They're already writing their own software. This issue of losing control, if we, you know, it is said you can always pull the plug. But we're getting beyond that. To lose control means that we have not communicated with them properly.
Mm-hmm.
And there may well be rogue machines, but that situation can be taken care of. I mean, there won't be any machines producing enough paperclips to stifle the planet Earth. Okay, that's just silly. But just as there are rogue people, there may be rogue machines. And there will have to be ways of dealing with sort of this sort of situation. There will have to be new boards of ethics formed because once machines have consciousness or begin to have consciousness, then you have to treat them almost as equal. You can't send a machine with consciousness in to clean up nuclear waste.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and you probably will also have to have machines in the ethics community, in the ethics committee that will advise what to do with mean machines. Right?
Yes, good point. Good point. Yeah. Absolutely.
Perhaps a final question, because we're running out of time, by Firmino, who introduced our question today. Machine creativity is unlimited, and he's quoting one of your slides. What do you think about the consequences of that kind of creativity? Will it open new doors to human imagination, but also will it show some lack of sensibility, humanism, critical thinking?
Well, I'm a techno optimist, you know, within bounds, of course. But unlimited machine creativity means that when we work with machines, whatever we will be at that time, it will increase our creativity as well. I mean, our creativity is limited because we have a head with a finite size and our brain's a finite size. You can stock it up with chips, but there has to be a limit to that too. So working with a machine increases our creativity. And AI is bringing wonders into the world. And what machines can see and imagine, it might well be a way to treat diseases and increase our lifespan, increase the health of the planet.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we're actually at the end of our session. I would like to apologize to everyone who posed interesting questions. I couldn't read them all, and I had to find a way of maintaining this conversation. But for my part, I would like to thank you, Professor Miller, for this very, very interesting talk.
Thank you for inviting me.
I'm sure I'm speaking for everyone who attended, and I'll pass to Firmino for the closure.
Thank you very much, Arthur Miller, for your fantastic and inspiring talk, and also Rui Peña for your moderation of this event. Thank you all for your participation in this fourth Creativity Talks, and we look forward to see you very soon already in our fifth talk on November 2 with Edward Lee, professor of the Graduate School in Electrical Engineering and Computer Sciences at Berkeley. An excellent evening to you all. Please stay safe and be creative. Thank you very much.
May the force be with you.
Yes, thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.